Good afternoon. Good afternoon and welcome. It's my great pleasure to welcome you all here to the School of International and Public Affairs at Columbia University. I'm Merit Janow, Dean of CEPA. And as you may know, our mission here at CEPA is to really equip emerging leaders with the skills, with the knowledge, and the global perspective to really take on the world's most critical public policy challenges. We're the multidisciplinary hub of policy research and engagement at Columbia University, and we've been engaging leaders on questions of global economic governance for nearly our entire history of some 70 years. And these are really very special occasions to have our students and our faculty and our friends grapple with difficult issues and talk to world leaders who are trying to advance the world's challenges. And tonight's evening is very much in that tradition. We're really delighted that the German finance minister is with us this evening. Thank you for making time on a short trip to the United States. He's really a critical policymaker in Europe today. And he comes to CEPA at such an interesting and important juncture in Europe. As Europe faces the aftermath of the global financial crisis and fundamental questions about the evolving nature of European economies, we're really eager to hear your thoughts and your invaluable perspective, and we look forward to the panel discussion that will follow. I'd like to thank Professor Jan Svenar, Director of the Center on Global Economic Governance and professor here at CEPA, for helping to organize this tonight and being a convener. And I'd like to acknowledge that yesterday, Jan, I'm not seeing you directly, there you are. Yesterday, Jan was awarded the very prestigious ISA Prize in Labor Economics, one of the most distinguished international awards in economics. We congratulate you for that achievement. Thank you. I'd also like to thank the World Leaders Forum for its work in putting this wonderful gathering tonight. And it's really my great pleasure to give the floor to John Coatsworth, Provost of Columbia University, former Dean of CEPA, to offer a few words on behalf of the university. Welcome and thank you.
Thank you, Dean Janow. It's a pleasure always to be back at the Columbia School of International and Public Affairs. I spent many happy years here. I'm now the provost in charge of the entire university, and I can tell you it's a mess. Compared to CEPA, which I have a great deal of nostalgia for. So I'm delighted to be able to welcome Minister Wolfgang Schäuble to Columbia on behalf of the university, and to extend warm greetings to all of you in this distinguished audience. First, a few words about the Center on Global Economic Governance. The CEPA Research Center that organized and co-sponsors this evening's event. CEPA's Center on Global Economic Governance was envisioned back in 2009 when the world was still reeling from the global financial crisis. The center was created as a space for thinking about, deliberating on, and even proposing sound economic policies that would help to keep us from falling into the same missteps that led to the crisis in the first place. I'm very pleased to see how Jan Svenar has taken the reins and built the center into such a successful institution. It took some doing to keep him here. He was considering at one point running for the presidency of his native Czech Republic, and you can imagine what the counter offer was that kept him here at Columbia. It was, I think, the costliest thing I did as Dean of CEPA. And I also want to congratulate him, as Merit has done, for winning the 2015 IZA Prize in Labor Economics. This is a prize, as you may know, awarded annually by the Center for the Study of Labor, the Institute for the Study of Labor in Bonn, and it was awarded for Jan's many contributions to this field of economics. So congratulations again, Jan. It has been my pleasure to have been involved in several of the Center's activities, ranging from its big BRIC lab conferences to its work with the World Bank on Global Development, and perhaps most importantly to its series on the future of Europe and the related work it is doing with the Columbia Global Centers in Rio and elsewhere, and on the role of the state in economic growth. It is through these kinds of events, led by Jan's Center for Global Economic Governance and our World Leaders Forum, that Columbia students have the opportunity to engage at the highest level the policy implications of what they are studying in their classrooms, and to participate in face-to-face discussions with world leaders who are making the actual policy decisions that are shaping our world's future. They have a real treat in store for them, you all do, this evening. I look forward to hearing Minister Schäuble's prognosis for Europe, as well as his thoughts, as well as the thoughts of our distinguished panelists. Now I'm pleased to pass the podium to Peter Jungen, who is a close friend of the university and with whom we've been working since I was dean of SIPA. Peter Jungen is a major business leader in Germany and a co-founder and investor in numerous startups in Europe and in the United States. He is a member of many boards, including the New York Philharmonic and the Institute for New Economic Thinking. Without Peter's assistance and support, we would not have been able to come together for this evening's event. So I'm happy to introduce Peter, who will introduce our keynote speaker for the evening. Peter.
Thank you, John, for your nice words of welcome. What a pleasure to be here tonight with and seeing so many friends, and John Cotsworth and General, and Nat Phelps and Joe Stieglitz and Jan Swainer, just to mention a few of them. With this, it gives me, of course, a particular pleasure to be here and to be able to introduce Minister Schäuble. Jan and I have been working on this for more than 1 year with the staff of the minister and with the minister in person. I remember, actually, it started one morning at 7:50, and there was a phone call at home, and my wife was on the phone, and she said, the Minister of Finance is on the phone, and I thought she was kidding me. but it was Wolfgang Schäuble, so finally we agreed last year to have the event. You came here to hear from Minister Schäuble, so we'll go straight into a short introduction. Wolfgang Schäuble is one of the longest serving members of the Bundestag ever, since the Bundestag has been constituted in, and he is a member since 1972 in a row. A few of the younger people were probably not born at the time in the room. He became a federal minister and the head of the Chancellor, the Bundeskanzleramt, the Chancellery, in Germany in 1984, and then the Minister of Interior in 89, which had a special importance because he negotiated then the treaty with the former DDR, East Germany, the Treaty on Unification, which finally led to German unity in parallel to 2+4 negotiations, and that was exactly about that time while we are here 25 years ago. Then he became the parliamentary chairman of the CDU-CSU. He was always a European. Juncker once called him a man at the frontier. This might, some people think, had different interpretations of that. Some said he's born close to the French border, so maybe that was the reason. Other people thought he was referring to that he may from time to time test frontiers of thinking, and in particular, and operating in critical situation. I think if I see him right, he feels that crises are good for Europe. If the pressure grows, joint solutions are forced on the EU, which never come to fruition in good times. He is, I would say, the most European in German politics and probably among all the European politicians today. He is actually a living continuation of the European unification process. Contrary to the belief of many, in the euro crisis, he was never alone. And in the meantime, he has now managed almost unity among the ECOFIN ministers as never before. The Wall Street Journal, about 2 weeks ago today, published a piece saying Berlin has been under fire from the global Keynesian economic establishment for insistence on balanced budget and debt reduction and skepticism of fiscal stimulus. I think this was a pretty good description of how Wolfgang Schäuble sees these problems. And it's fair to say that if this is considered to be a German view, as some people said for the last couple of years, the German view seems to become more and more, if not yet already, a mainstream view in the Eurozone. At least it's finally growing, as I don't know whether Beuter is here, but they published just a piece in saying that above the average that they see next year, a 2% growth rate for the Eurozone. Wolfgang Schäuble, if I see him as a person, well, he is tough, he is straightforward, he is sharp-minded, and he has a lot of wit, and he could be very, very humorous. He has a lot of energy, and he is very sensitive, and a music lover. Last year, when the American Chamber of Commerce, AmCham, awarded a Transatlantic Partnership Award jointly on the New York Philharmonic and the Berlin Philharmonic in Berlin, to the surprise of many, Wolfgang Schäuble was the one who held the Laudatio. I think many people were surprised to find out that there is another life for him outside the Eurozone and the Ministry of Finance. He recently gave a lecture on Bismarck relating to April 1st, 1815, when Bismarck was born during the, or shortly before the Vienna Congress. And in that he underlined that Germany in 1871 was a multi-level federal system with a very complicated structure. Relating this to the present situation in Europe, he added, we learn how important it is to acknowledge the interests and sensibilities of all partners involved. In his recent book, Stephen Green, in the book The Reluctant Meister, writes about the necessary and emerging leadership role of Germany. Maybe Stephen Green had someone like Wolfgang Schäuble in his mind. On a more personal note, as we know each other for many years, exactly now 31 years these days or weeks, and we have many interactions, I'd like to add, for me, he is one of the most respected politicians I have known in my life, if not the most. It is therefore my sincere pleasure to invite you to take the floor. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Peter Jung, for your very kind introduction. And ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, thank you very much for your great honor to be here and for your readiness to listen to me, because political members always like to get some people who are ready to listen. So I would like since I have got the information that all speakers are under a very restricted time limit, let me get straight to the point. Since the 70s, expansive debt-financed fiscal policies have been the rule, not the exception, in industrial societies, with moderate success. Growth rate declined nevertheless. For more than two decades, economic policy in industrialized countries tried to mediate recessions and financial market crises by increasing the leverage of the public and private sector and multiplying the money supply. To be fair, these policies were necessary to cope with the immediate crisis, but they tend to sow the seeds for the next one. With increased financial globalization, the risk of systemic crisis accelerated and recovery costs rose steeply. I'm not only thinking of fiscal costs here, but problems like rising inequality, radical and religious tensions, straining the bonds that bind our societies. Is there an alternative to these repetitive cycles of credit booms followed by busts? I think there is. It's the model of moderate but sustained growth, defined as steady, environmentally friendly, and inclusive growth. Moderate growth points to the economic heart of the matter, to decline in productivity growth, which is at the core of the decline in growth rates and wage growth in advanced countries. Surprisingly, the beginning IT revolutions in the 90s coincided with a slowdown in productivity growth. This is so surprising that economists call this observation Solow paradox. Solow because of the Nobel laureate who was the first economic celebrity who pointed out this paradox. Unfortunately, he did not explain the paradox. So what is the explanation for decreasing productivity growth since the 90s? Perhaps the Solow paradox is explained by globalization, by the fact that large emerging countries were integrated into the world economy. As a result, a large reservoir of relatively low-skilled workers has been created. Between 1980 and 2010, the number of jobs grew by 1.1 billion. 900 million came from developing countries. These workers compete with workers in developed countries. If labor is cheap and abundant, it makes little sense to invest in labor-saving and productivity-enhancing technologies. So advanced economies do not take full advantage of productivity gains via digitalization. So at least that argument goes. I do not find it particularly convincing. Given that wages in Europe are higher and labor scarcer, productivity growth in Europe should be higher than in the United States, which is not the case. Another explanation is that technological progress increases productivity only after delay. A third explanation is that the digital revolution is perhaps not as transformative as the industrial revolution, and especially not transformative enough to compensate for the effects of demographic change and high public debt. Could be. But the explanation I find most convincing is that the exceptional rise in productivity during the Industrial Revolution was aided by three additional factors. It occurred because it was accompanied by the introduction of compulsory education, which raised the productivity of labor significantly. Secondly, because it was accompanied by the abolition of serfdom, which gave workers the opportunity to look for more profitable occupations than agriculture. And thirdly, because it was accompanied by the rule of law and well-functioning institutions protecting property rights and allowing people to reap the benefits of the work and ideas in the market. Of course, an increase in productivity in a given sector always means a reduction in labor supply in the same sector. In 1900, around 40% of Americans worked in agriculture, and slightly more than 40% of the average household budget was spent on food. Over the next century, automation reduced employment in agriculture to less than 5%, and food costs fell dramatically. But at the time, the excess supply of labor was relatively easily absorbed in new sectors of the economy, which was relatively easy given the training that is the higher productivity of the US workforce. But getting a proper education well suited for today's labor markets is not as easy as it once was. Particularly, labor markets in advanced economies suffer from a lack of skilled workers. A mismatch of skills demanded and supplied by labor markets in advanced economies explain high unemployment rates, particularly when wages tend to be sticky. In Europe, it's not so much academics that are missing, but workers who have successfully completed a vigorous apprenticeship program with a mix of craft-specific and technical training. But the consequences of the increase in low-skilled labor by developing countries and the decrease in productivity by developed countries is by no means only a European problem. On the contrary, it is at the root of the economic and social problems in the United States too. It's recurring fiscal crisis and growing inequality. It's no coincidence that the financial crisis started in the United States and its real estate sector. U.S. policymakers tried to promote home ownership of poorly skilled workers by having less stringent lending practices. U.S. policymakers attempted to maintain high levels of growth and compensate for low wage growth and rising levels of inequality by means of monetary policy and a higher leverage of the public and private sector. Helping poorly skilled workers and their family is praiseworthy, but lax monetary and lending policies are no replacement for good social policies and education. Sure, there are adverse incentives in European labor markets to find work quickly, which we are correcting, by the way. But despite all its faults, Europe's system is not badly designed for achieving equality of opportunity and alleviating social inequality. It does this by providing for affordable education, universal health care, and the redistribution of income. In Europe, moderate and sustained growth implies structural reforms and the deleveraging of public and private sectors. Done right, structural reforms and fiscal consolidation are complements, not trade-offs. In the medium term, a smaller public sector and more flexible labor markets help trim expenditures and lift growth. And a quick implementation of reforms will strengthen consumer and investor confidence, canceling out any short-term dip in consumption. The talk of the so-called European austerity is not supported by facts, as Peter Jungen already pointed at a recent conference of the Columbia Center on Global Economic Governance. The absolute level of debt in Europe is higher than before the crisis began, and the debt-to-GDP ratio in the Eurozone is higher than ever before. The Bank of International Settlements thinks that the indebtedness on the private and public sector, including the high leverage of banks and households, as well as a lack of structural reforms, hinders sustainable growth, especially in Europe. And I think they are right. Moderate and sustained growth requires that we align our debt and deficit ratios with our growth ratios, and that we implement structural reforms to increase productivity. What does this mean? By structural reforms to increase productivity, I mean enhancing labor market flexibility, increasing labor productivity through greater investment in physical and human capital, raising the retirement age, thus reducing social spending, facilitating migration and women's integration into the labor force. And the fiscal policy guideline is that under normal economic circumstances, the rate of public expenditure should not rise faster than the nominal growth rate. The question for the euro area is, can we adhere to the rules which prescribe structural reforms and fiscal consolidation in the euro area? I think we can, and we have to, because of the special conditions of European governance. Here I mean the structure of the European Union and the currency union. The members of the euro area have transferred their monetary sovereign rights, making powers to the European Central Bank. But still the member states dominate the fiscal and economic policy of the euro area. It's of utmost importance that such a construct of semi-sovereign states adheres to the rules they have given themselves to keep the common monetary and economic area intact. In fact, European governments do just that since the beginning of the crisis, sometimes more, sometimes less, but the direction is clear. And as a result, growth is returning. And the competitiveness of the program countries, Spain, Ireland, Portugal, is increasing. Even Greece did much better before what happened in the last, after the last election. We will not mention it. And even Cyprus is doing much better than everyone expected, by the way, this fifth country on the program. Unit labor costs are lower. Current account deficits have declined markedly, and least partly due to the successful exports. A decrease in unemployment rates is visible. Germany bolsters its position as Europe's fiscal and economic anchor. Oh, what's going on? Of course, the situation of some member states of the Eurozone, notably Greece, remains serious. But European Monetary Union won't succeed if a member country weakens its competitiveness and persistently runs large deficits to finance consumption. Such policies would be at the expense of the euro area stability. By supporting Greece and later on Ireland, Portugal, Spain, Cyprus, we prevented the collapse of international financial markets, perhaps avoiding another recession of the world economy. And we have given reformed countries financial bracing space by means of low interest rate loans while they implement structural reforms. This, in addition to institutional changes, first and foremost, an European banking union, and a flexible but stronger fiscal framework for member states, has been part of an overall concept to put us on track for moderate and sustained growth. Overall, Europe's policies are sound. By fits and starts, by trial and error, we will improve on these policies. And this is how open societies should work. And this is how European societies do work. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister Schäuble, for a fascinating and rich analysis of the situation. We will now turn to the second part, where the three panelists, started with Alessandra Casella, then Ned Phelps, and Joe Stiglitz, will each react for about 5 minutes. We have a timekeeper here who will keep them a stringent limit. I will say a few words afterwards, and then we'll turn to Minister Schäuble again for his reaction, and then we will open things for the question and answers from the public here. So, Alessandra, welcome, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Minister Schäuble, for such a forthcoming speech. I did not know that finance ministers could be so clear, so this has been a discovery. I think that there is a lot to debate, nevertheless, in the speech we just heard, starting from the very beginning with the attribution of not only violent booms and busts, but also social and religious and inequality, all sorts of problematic social divisions to overactive economic policy. And we are talking now, hopefully, towards the end, the beginning of our recovery in Europe, after many years that many of us attribute to, in fact, in part, a lack of active macro policy. So there is much to debate, but I will not do that. I will leave that to my co-panelists. And that's easy. And I will make the most, instead, of Minister Schäuble's presence here to ask him two questions. The first question I would like to ask is about the long-term design of the European Monetary Union. So I would like to know, as concretely as possible, what are the goals, but also what are the political constraints under which we should operate? Because seen from New York, seen from here, cooperation in the monetary union still seems to leave a lot to be desired, or there is at least room for improvement. And we academics love to come up with new ideas, new mechanisms. But what we don't know is what political constraints we should respect and impose on the new rules that we would like to invent. So, for example, Professor Stiglitz has proposed transforming the Greek debt into GDP-indexed bonds. That seems to make tremendous amount of sense because it would align the incentives and the interests of the debtors and the creditors, and it would avoid a too punitive regime. But is that feasible? Is that politically feasible? And if not, why not? So this is one question, and one aspect of that question is more specific and relates to the possibility of a Greek exit. Supposing that Greece were to exit, and supposing, and this second supposition I find quite strong, but supposing that there is no major market turmoil for the countries that remains in the Union right now, nevertheless, the unprecedented exit of one member of the Union would create a substratum of uncertainty that could be very destabilizing, it seems to me, and so should presumably be countered by new measures, new signals to the market about the cohesion of the group that remains. Is that something that is being planned? Is there a plan B that anticipates what measures could be taken then? That is all my question one. Question two, well, there were two aspects of the same question, right? So, and my timekeeper hasn't jumped up yet. So my question two, relates to moral hazard. So what we always hear, that it's really important to be strict, otherwise other countries will learn to borrow and not repay, et cetera. And I see two problems with this. One problem is that I just don't find credible that a country would want to go through what Greece went through just to avoid repaying debt, but that's one problem. The second one is more interesting, and I think it's more conceptual. And it's the fact that I think this is a way of thinking that identifies a country with a single decision maker. But this is not the case. A country is many, many, many people, and mostly it's a culture. So there is a problem of collective norms. The original sin in Greece was a culture of non-transparency, of non-accountability. And I think everybody else wants to reform this culture into increasing the transparency and the accountability. The question is, how do you get there? Is it obvious that by really punishing Greece, the country, by possibly causing the exit from Europe, we would make this more likely? In Italy, for example, the one strong initiative against corruption was Mani Pulite in the 90s. It failed, so that's a problem, so I won't go there. But it is widely believed that one of the reasons it even happened, why did it happen in the 90s when we all knew that the system was corrupt? I was in Italy at the time. One of the reasons, the leading reason, is probably Europe. And so from my perspective, it would seem that keeping Greece in Europe and supporting Greece while it goes through this very painful, very difficult, but fundamental process of deep social reform would be a better way of achieving the goal. And also, by the way, to put back on the table some of the ideals that Europe had at the very beginning, right? Europe as a light forward, as a guide. So I wanted to ask Minister Schäuble, in his experience, what are the best mechanisms to try to achieve this type of transformation? This was the end of the second question. Right. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. You stayed within the time limit and certainly asked provocative questions. Ned Phelps, next.
Right. I'm greatly honored to be invited here to discuss the presentation by Minister Schäuble. There's so much here with which I agree. I too have suggested that the fiscal deficits and financial leveraging in the private sector in recent years are responses to worsened economic performance. They're not the causes, they're not the primary causes. And the deterioration of balance sheets adds fuel to the next crisis. I too believe that the declines in productivity growth are at the core of the declines of economic performance in the West. But I disagree with him about the deeper causes of that. A thesis of my book, Mass Flourishing, is that the productivity slowdowns that came to the West first the U.S. in the mid-60s, then France and Italy in the late 90s, and finally Britain and Germany in the early 2000s, resulted from slower innovation by the last innovator standing, the U.S. American innovation came to be impeded in the established industries and has flowered mainly by creating new industries, but it has less space to work with. Minister Schäuble comments that Europe's economies are well designed for equality of opportunity and social equity, though he wants moderate and sustained growth through structural reforms. It may be that Europe comes fairly close to having a just economy, perhaps closer than the U.S. does. But Europe is far from having a good economy, perhaps farther than the U.S. is. What's a good economy? What do I mean by that? A good economy, I will mean, is one that offers widespread opportunities for a good life, a life of richness, as some humanists call it, some of them right around here. In the economy, that good life means prospering, means gaining mastery and experience in one's work, thus gaining better and better terms for oneself. It's deeply satisfying. And the good economy means flourishing, exercising one's creativity, doing something imaginative, journeying into the unknown, acting on the world. For most people, flourishing, which can be seen as succeeding of an entirely non-material sort, appears to be necessary for a life of richness. Succeeding in a material way is not enough. Europe's economies are now radically different than they once were. They do little more than let global market forces, including advances in science at home and abroad, pull up the going level of wage rates and prop up the market rates of return on wealth. This is a pathetic economy, next to the nations in the past where wide numbers of people were prospering and flourishing. Today there is little prospering and less flourishing. How did Europe wind up there? The answer, in part, I think, is the influence of standard economics. In standard economics, no one is attempting to improve, to venture, and perchance to succeed. There is no human agency, only responses to wage rates, interest rates, and wealth. The economy is mechanical, robotic. The standard theory, standard economics, despite its enormous sophistication in some respects, has left no room for economies in which people are imagining new products and using their creativity to build some of them. What is most fundamentally wrong with Europe, I think, is that it takes such a passive economy as the norm, as to be, well, this is as good as it gets. So when a once imaginative, once creative economy slips into the classical mode, economics has no handbook of cures to revitalize it. What can Europe do? Well, to obtain an economy enabling wide prosperity and flourishing, a nation will require not only the right set of institutions, it will require the development of an economy with the right culture. And the question on my mind, and maybe I'll find out some of the answers this afternoon, the question on my mind is whether the Europeans really want that.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ned. Very provocative and insightful. And we'll turn to Joe Stiglitz.
Well, I agree a lot with what everybody has said before, but as you can imagine, there are some nuances that I'll take. So first, I agree very strongly that the risk of the private sector growth that the minister emphasized. I've also strongly criticized that. I disagree, however, that we need to accept the low growth, what is euphemistically called moderate growth. I believe it should be inclusive and sustained, but the low growth to which Europe and the world has sunk. Just for those of you who haven't seen the forecast that came out today, the IMF forecast for Europe is 1.5%, and that's truly disappointing, given that it's been 8 years since the beginning of the recession. You know, usually when the economy goes down, you expect a bounce back. 1.5% is not a bounce back, and I'll come back to that in a minute. My agenda includes some of the elements stressed by the minister, which includes a pro-equality, pro-education. But here's where I really differ. I think we need more investment in people, in infrastructure, in technology, and that requires a larger, not a smaller, public sector. And Casella pointed out a lot of the problems the U.S. got into was because the government wasn't doing what it was supposed to. And I don't know whether you enjoy coming into Kennedy Airport, but my own feeling is it's actually an embarrassment. Well, let me talk, most importantly, my take on your economy is markedly different from that of the minister and much closer to that of Ned. I see several countries still in depression. I use that word deliberately. When I was chief economist of the World Bank, we were told not to use the word depression to describe what was going on in East Asia. We had to say they were experiencing a D or an R, depending whether depression or recession. But Europe, many of the countries are experiencing depression. It's the only word you can use when the average unemployment rate in Europe is 12%. The youth unemployment, the average youth unemployment rate is twice that, 25%. In the worst countries like Spain, the youth unemployment rate is 50%. In Greece, it's higher than that. A whole generation is being destroyed. And in that process of destruction, the future prospects of Europe are being weakened. The destruction of future growth prospects for Europe, the negative effects on potential growth, are far, far larger from this destruction in growth than any structural policies that have been introduced. So the net effect of all the programs has been actually to undermine the future of Europe. Now, while as a Midwesterner, we are noted for our optimism. I come from Indiana. But, and I have enormous respect for hope, should I say the audacity of hope, to quote President Obama. But we have heard that Europe is about to turn a corner over and over again. I hope he's right, but I wouldn't count on it. Yes, it is better that Spain's unemployment today is only 23.2%. Only 23.2%. And that's better than 25%. And in fact, that it's going down is a good thing. But it'll be only another 20 years before it gets to a normal level. And to me, that should be viewed as unacceptable. What exists is partially result of, what growth exists is partially a result of a competitive devaluation, which improves growth, Europe's growth rate, but at the expense of other countries. Relative to the even modest trend growth of the Eurozone between 1980 and 2007, which I would have called moderate, but and it certainly wasn't as good as it was before 1980, output today is more than 15% lower than projected, a cumulative loss between actual and potential output of trillions, I said trillions, not billions, trillions of dollars, of euros, with the gap increasing, not decreasing. By all accounts, the crisis and the way it has been managed will lead to, as I said before, significantly lower potential growth for the future. By all accounts, the failure to manage aggregate demand today has a far, far bigger effect on Europe's future productivity than all of the so-called supply-side measures. Even growth in the best performing European countries has been dismal and has been based on the growth of current account surpluses that risk world economic stability. Before the crisis, the U.S. rightly warned of China's huge surpluses as contributing to unsustainable global imbalances. Today, Northern Europe surpluses are even larger. The implications for global stability should be clear. And as Keynes pointed out so clearly, it is the surplus countries' policies that are as much or more responsible for these global imbalances. Worse still, growing inequality has meant that large fractions of the citizens of the so-called good-performing economies have been seeing stagnating incomes. I agree with the minister's praise of certain European institutions, its provision of affordable education, its universal health care, the more active role it takes in redistribution. How then do we account for its poor performance, even relative to the U.S.? It is not, I believe, because of America's more flexible labor market institutions. A code word for suggesting that there should be even weaker job protections and lower wages for the poorest workers. In the depth of the recession, America performed even more poorly in the labor market than Germany, even though we had a greater labor market flexibility. Today, the problem holding Europe, and to a large extent the world, back is lack of demand. Countries that cut back most suffered the greatest reduction in output, and the hope for improvements in fiscal positions have not occurred. It is the slow growth caused by austerity that caused the debt, not the other way around. As a large number of econometric studies investigating causality have demonstrated, and of which Spain provides the obvious example, a country with a surplus before the crisis and a low debt-to-GDP ratio. In Europe especially, public austerity has been accompanied by cutbacks in lending to small and medium-sized enterprises, a result of a flawed structure to the Eurozone. What is needed in Europe is a reform to the structure of the Eurozone itself, including not only of a banking union, which the minister talked about, with common deposit insurance and common resolution, but more of a fiscal union. These are among the basic institutions which enable the U.S. common currency to work. To repeat, it is reform in the structure of the Eurozone that is needed far more than the structural reforms within individual countries. The rules are wrong and have to be changed. Some of the countries that are having problems today had rapid productivity growth and high levels of productivity before the crisis. Did their educational systems suddenly fail? Did their labor market institutions suddenly change? No. What changed was the introduction of a flawed currency arrangement. The notion that it is debt and deficits that are at the root of the problem have, I thought, been already thoroughly debunked, including the refutation of the Reinhardt-Rogoff work. But let me briefly repeat the arguments. It is not public debt that causes crises, though unrestrained private debts do. And I also want to mention that the bipartisan U.S. Financial Inquiry Commission, the causes of the U.S. crisis, emphasized it was not, government attempts to increase housing for the poor that was the root of the crisis. This was an idea that a lot of the Republicans have tried to push repeatedly and was investigated by a bipartisan commission, and they said that idea was absolutely wrong. And only one of the members of the commission, a Republican, said that there was any truth in that allegation. I think it's really, one shouldn't repeat that kind of an allegation, which blames the victim for what they have suffered. So the cutbacks in public spending have been compounded by the failures to support the banks in the afflicted countries, so that there has been the disastrous decline in SME lending to which I referred earlier. Internal devaluations have never worked, partly because they result in an increase in leverage, and the improvements in their current account balances have been disproportionately a result of a decrease in imports, not an increase in exports. Let me say just a word about structural reform. All countries need structural reforms constantly. But the fundamental problem, as I have said, is the structure of the Eurozone. Many of the structural reforms contribute to a weakening of aggregate demand and thus weaken the economy. And because of the destruction of human capital that is going on en masse, they weaken the potential for future growth and the potential for future flourishing. On-the-job training and learning is every bit as important as formal schooling. Many, even within academia, where we do the formal schooling, agree with this view. Even worse, little thought has been given to prioritization of the structural reforms. Which of them would make a real difference? There seems to be have been no cost-benefit analysis. And finally, let me say, too, that economic recession or depression is not the best time to engage in these reforms. Finally, let me note that we are meeting here in a university where we strive to achieve a better understanding of the economy and to create better models. We need to admit that the models used by the Troika were very, very badly flawed. They have repeatedly misforecast by magnitudes that ought to be viewed as unacceptable. I would expect my students to learn from a model that worked so badly, to figure out what was wrong with that model. My remarks earlier suggested that actually we know what is wrong. What I don't understand, though, is why the learning that might be expected has not occurred. Even the IMF has pointed out that the idea of contraction or expansion is wrong. I understand grasping the straws of success. As said before, a Spanish unemployment rate that has fallen to 23.2%, the signs that things may be bottoming out. But every downturn eventually comes to an end. What matters is how long and how deep, how much suffering, how robust the recovery. I wish I could share the minister's optimism. I hope he's right that we are about to turn a corner. I guess we'll see with time.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Joel. If I call the comments of the first two panelists provocative, I don't know what words to use for the third one. But, it certainly was fruitful and thought-provoking. I, of course, agree with all of them. So my comments will be just a small addition to what was already said. So one thing on a sort of specific thing. I heard somewhere that actually this idea of GDP index bonds was used in Germany in the early 1950s. Is that the case? And if so, was that successful? And is that something that really should be used? I'm just throwing that out. On the point that you mentioned on apprenticeship and technical training as being needed and being in short supply, I hear that very often all over Europe. Even, and I'm surprised, even in countries like Germany, Switzerland, and others that really have strong apprenticeship tradition and technical training, if so, why aren't the firms providing more of it? They historically have and do, and in some sense it seems to me that if just raising the wages and providing the training, the supply should adjust. So what is it that's really preventing this kind of adjustment from taking place? Because I think it is serious. And then I have one sort of bigger question. With some economists in Prague, in the Czech Republic, we were asking the question, how about should the Czech Republic, Poland, these countries that are still not part of the Eurozone, should they actually join? So recently, many of you may have heard, the Baltic countries have actually joined the Eurozone, and so there is clearly demand to enter this area that's questioned as being viable and so on and so forth. Now, they may have special reasons, being on the border close to Russia, right, and everything. So we said, how about these countries in Central Europe? So we did a study and took the Czech Republic and did as sophisticated a study as can be done. And the answer is, yes, the Czech Republic should enter whichever Eurozone Germany is in. So my question is, I guess, would you agree with me and the study students, et cetera, that countries like the Czech Republic and Poland should indeed join the Eurozone, not necessarily tomorrow, but let's say in some kind of short to medium term. All right, on that note, we'll turn things to you again. And unlike the panelists, you don't have any time constraint. So.
It's very kind, but since we want to move to Q&A as well, I will apologize not to react on any question and any comment. I think we would need some additional days to get a common position with Professor Stiglitz to be, of course, but I am full of respect, but maybe I can answer some very specific questions and then I make some very few general remarks. I am totally in favor of for the Czech and Czech Republic and Poland and the other member states will join the euro as soon as they decide to do so. Mm-hmm. By the way, not only the Baltic states, Slovakia. If you may have, and then don't think to leave the eurozone, not at all.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right.
Having said this, you underestimate the challenge we have to face in Europe to overcome the heritage of the division of Europe over decades. I could tell you a long story on overcoming the division in Germany, even. Mm-hmm. Then from Germany, division of Germany from 1945 to 1989 or 1990. Yeah. And that is a huge challenge as well. Coming to the question of what is the long-term designs of the eurozone, and that is one major issue I agree with Professor Stiglitz. The given construction of the eurozone is not sustainable for the long term. That is not surprising. We knew it in advance. When we started this discussion on creating a monetary union in 1987, it was Jacques Delors. It was before the German reunification. It was when this discussion came up, speed up in after your reunification, and then the discussion was, wouldn't we need a political union in advance, not only to have a monetary union, but also have to have a fiscal and economic union? If we would have decided to do so, what would have been economically the better for your students, it's the better way to solve the problems, by far. But reality is sometimes a little bit more complicated. And therefore, in European history, we always moved in a very imperfect way, step by step. By the way, we tried, or our parents tried to create a European integration after World War II with the political union. At the end, they failed in the French Assembly in 1945. That is the story. And then we decided, let's go step by step by increasing economic integration, and further steps will follow. And so we started with the monetary union, having in mind, without a fiscal and economic union, it will not work for eternity. It will not be sustainable. That's what we got as lesson from all the professors and teachers on how monetary unions can work and or not. That's right, I agree 100%. Therefore, I'm working again and again and again to strengthen the governance of the eurozone. And I bet you will be surprised if we will have an additional crisis. That may happen in Europe, by sure. Then we will use any crisis to strengthen European integration, strengthening the governance. What we, by the way, did in the last couple of years of the so-called euro crisis. We have already strengthened the governance of the eurozone, impressively, not sufficient. We always only get second-best solutions, but I am in favor to say second-best is better than nothing. It's not sufficient, but it's better than nothing. So we work on from crisis to crisis. We improve. Therefore, I'm optimistic. Without crisis, I don't know how the U.S. works. In U.S., it's much more stringent, and if you take a decision in White House, Congress agrees, and everything is fine. In Europe, it's much more complicated. You have to have in mind, we started with, and actually we have 28 member states in the European Union. They used to be all sovereign nation states, proud sovereign nation states, with long histories. And they have to give up step by step parts of national sovereignty. Decisions you can't imagine in US, by the way. You can't imagine. But if you want to get a relevant Europe without integration, it's impossible. Therefore, we have to deliver it in Europe. It's very difficult. We do it step by step, in trial and error. But since we never waste a good crisis. We use any crisis as an opportunity. Yep, and therefore we have a lot of chances because we are sure we will get much aggressive. We will get, and you will see it. It will work again and again. We have. You wouldn't have imagined, Professor Stiglitz, that we would be ready, would be able to deliver a banking union in such a limited time. When our heads of states and governments decided in summer 2012 we will create a banking union, nobody believed that we would. We did it. It's implemented. It works. We will get a capital market union. And I think you will, better than you expect, we will get a fiscal union as well. And that is, for the long term, my design on your question, how we have to work in this direction. By the way, we need Italy, because Italy has always been in favor of more integration institutional. But of course we need, it's much better to have institutions instead of rules. We started in the monetary union with rules, and we failed to stick to the rules. And the leading countries have been France and Germany, by the way. And so we have to improve the rules, and we are, but in some ways we are doing. I would say, of course, if you ask a finance minister and you don't imagine that he's an idiot, he will never answer whether there's a plan B. We have no plan. We have no plan A, we have no plan B. We have no plan, absolutely not. But I have been strongly criticized as Minister of Interior not to have a plan for German reunification. But if I would have said we have a plan for German reunification, we are working on a plan for German reunification, let's say some months before the Berlin Wall came down, everybody in all over the world had said, this Interior Minister must be crazy to work on such a thing. Does he want to take at risk the peace in the world? Well, so I have no plan B. We don't work on any plan. No, believe me. But I think that the strengthening the governance, the coherence of the Eurozone is the solution. Until we get it, we have to care on second best, that is increasing the coherence step by step. And like. Having said this, I do not, look, it's, I can imagine that you can't, I think you can't really imagine how strong is this so-called moral hazard problem in Europe. You know that some member states who joined the Eurozone from the very beginning, including Italy, by the way, but even more Greece, they enjoyed low interest rates since joining the Eurozone. They never have enjoyed before. Mm-hmm. And they wasted the opportunity because it was not a crisis, it was an opportunity. And you have always to start with the crisis and then you can use it for an opportunity. And the other way around, it doesn't work. And so they forget to increase their competitiveness. I will not mention on the many problems which Greece is facing by tradition, which we all know. And therefore, I have always argued in Europe and in German public discussions that we have to understand Greece. It's a very specific problem. But of course, even the Greek, even Greece has to deliver some way, someday, a way to live to their own expectations. That is the main problem. As long as they want to live by far beyond their expectation, it will not work. And that cannot work on end. By the way, it's a very strong criticized by you, Troika, which is now we call it the institutions. And the one sentence later, you have a prize, the IMF. The IMF is part of this institution. They have, the only concern is not fiscal, it's not austerity, it's fiscal discipline. The major concern is, and the major question is, to get access to finance markets, some days. In the case of Greece, we agreed to design the program under the assumption that Greece will get again access to financial markets in 2020. It was very difficult on behalf of the rules of the IMF to agree for such an ambitious program. We did it. By the way, we agreed on a haircut at 53%. And if you know, I am the German finance minister, I know very well, the most participation in this haircut was the German taxpayers. No one else. We have by far the highest contribution for this city. We did it. Not to, okay, it's fine. But in, and Greece has delivered better than expected until last election. I can imagine, maybe if I would be a young people in Greece or a citizen in Greece, I don't know what I would elect for. But I have told Prime Minister Tsipras, if you promise to your electors in campaigning that you will get recovery and staying in the Eurozone without sticking to any program, you will suffer a major problem if you will be elected. It has been foreseen. Sometimes you have to stick to what you promise, and then otherwise you have. So if Greece has to find a way, we will help them wherever we can, but Greece has to find a way how Greece will someday regain confidence in financial markets. That is what we call, and that is to regain a competitive economy. And having said this, I would like to make one comment to Professor Phelps. What is a good economy? What is a good economy? When I tried to say, and I knew very well what I did in saying a moderate economy is a sustainable, a moderate growth is a sustainable economy. I know this was very risky, but I did it. I wanted to make some provocation as well, of course, but sure. Mm-hmm. What is the potential growth in U.S. economy? What is the potential growth in U.S. economy? I know the potential growth in Europe. I am strongly in favor to increase the readiness for innovation. But you know the Europeans are very risk averse. There's a huge risk diversity, and you may have to make policy for the people you their lives are, not for the people you want to have. I cannot elect my, change my people. No. We have to do as elected people, as representatives, we have to stick what people want to do. And the Europeans are a little bit tired. The Europeans have a huge demand for security. They are not very in favor of innovation. I think since we speed up, and American government, since the very beginning, we did in Greece, we make no austerity policies. That's, by the way, it's real. It doesn't fit with any number. It's not true. But what we did was we increased expenditure of federal government. We are only responsible for federal government, of course, for research, science, education, much more than in any government before. But we have, and that is one of the key elements why we have increased German competitiveness. And if you want to get your societies more innovative, you have to rely on education, research and education, to tell them. It's by the way, our vocational training system is one of our best assets all over Europe. And we do it more and more European member states try to. We have a lot of bilateral partnerships. We do it at the European level. Spain, for example, is introducing the system. France is, Italy is doing it this way, because that is one of the assets. If you look a little bit more in concrete at the real numbers, even of youth unemployment, it's sometimes a lack of mobility in part of the young generation. I could tell you, I could deliver a speech on the youth unemployment of Spain.
Let's go for it.
It will take too much time. I would tell you, if we enhance, if we rely only on increase the numbers of students in university, we will fail. Mm-hmm. We have already today one of the limits for potential growth is the decreasing number of skilled workers. You need skilled workers
much better trade. That's where we rely on, and I think we are not so as bad as you think. And if you look at the numbers, what is, if you look at the forecast of the IMF with all due respect, what is the forecast of growth for US economy, and what's the forecast of growth for European economy? If you, I think it's, US has much more capacities for stronger growth, with all respect. And having said this, I think if we can do it in some way with a moderate growth, in my reading, it can be a sustainable economy. And I am very much in favor of sustainability, and I think this will be a good economy. And last remark, I would like to quote Janet Yellen, who has in the last couple of months several times said that the increasing number of liquidity, central bank money, and of course public and private debt, creates increasing inequality. I think an increasing inequality in an advanced society is not a good economy. Therefore, I am in favor of moderate but sustainable growth.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So we'll now turn to the audience, and I would like to invite Ambassador Donald Blinken, who I'd also like to recognize him and his wife Vera. They've been spearheading European studies at Columbia in a major way. So thank you very much. And if you would be willing to ask the first question, we'll open the floor to questions. I think the microphone is right here.
I would also like to join the panelists in thanking Minister Schäuble for spending time with us here at Columbia. His remarks are very valuable and very interesting. Europe has undergone a great deal of trauma in the last decade, both the European countries and to some degree European institutions. And this also has, I think, some effect on the world, its financial institutions as well. A new factor has entered the equation, the introduction by China of a investment in an infrastructure bank, which Germany has embraced. All of this suggests to me that perhaps it's time for a new Bretton Woods. And my question to the minister is, should there be in the next few years a worldwide convention similar to Bretton Woods to re-examine both the international institutions and the domestic responses to them? And if such a meeting was held, what role would Germany play in this kind of a discussion?
All right, thank you very much. While the minister answers the question, if there are other people who would like to, please come to the microphone and prepare.
I don't think that a new Bretton Woods would be a solution for the problems of the global economy. But I am very much in favor, and Germany will take this position, and Europe will, and we will work in Europe, that Europe as a whole and the Eurozone will take this position, that we engage ourselves as much as possible in global responsibility, in solutions on to get better global governance as well. You have, if I got right, mentioned in the beginning this issue of the Asian Development Bank of China. I think we should, I was a little bit disappointed that we couldn't get a common position of the G7 in this issue, but we have managed to do it in close contacts, in close cooperation, to get a common position as much as possible, because we will not succeed in get a more stable economic system if we parts we member states of the so-called Western world or the Western, if we will not work together for common solutions. Of course, we have to have in mind we have a responsibility for emerging economies as well. We have a responsibility for the developing countries as well. We have to be of course, U.S. have to be a very specific and indispensable role for global leadership. The Europeans have to contribute in a close partnership, knowing that there's a clear difference between both. But we cannot lead, and we will not get solutions if we will not be successful even in what has been it's some years ago when an American author, it was Joseph Nye, said there's hard power and there's soft power. No country can lead the global world, the global economy, global policy only by hard power in this 21st century. We will fail. Everyone will fail. Therefore, we need more soft power. And soft power at the end is responsibility and reciprocity.
All right, thank you very much.
Maybe we will discuss the IMF quota reforms in the coming days to give a concrete example for reciprocity.
All right. I would ask each speaker to just briefly introduce yourself and ask the question. Thank you.
My name is Shaukat Aziz. I'm the former Prime Minister of Pakistan and before that, Finance Minister of Pakistan. and a simple banker, have worked in this city, in Greece, and many other countries you talked about today. Mr. Minister, you gave a very interesting and very informative speech. Clearly, in your speech, you highlighted the need for structural reforms in a wide variety of areas, and so did some of the other panelists. In my limited experience in a very difficult country, challenging country, structural reforms create a lot of dislocation, pain, political cost. And one of the things which my question isn't this partly a leadership issue? Because to conduct reforms in any environment, developed, developing, or underdeveloped, you need leadership. Because you have to bite a lot of bullets. There's a lot of pain till you get the gain. And are we we should emphasize the fact that leadership is the key criteria to get a really conducive economic policy going. And if you want successful reforms, leadership is needed. I'd like your comments on that part. Thank you.
Yes, of course, leadership is needed, but leadership is in a democratic society an ambitious challenge, and you can see all over the world. Therefore, you have to convince your constituency. Therefore, that is one of the reasons I am really convinced, not to make jokes, that we must never waste a good crisis, because without pressure. In my reading, it's the nature of the human being. When I was a student, and I have to deliver a paper, only in the last night, I was very under pressure. It works. Without, it's difficult, and that is one of the reasons the problems in it's a moral hazard I mentioned in Europe. As long as you have, as political leader, member of government, member of parliament, whatever, in a local community as well as in a federal state or in a government, as far as you have a more convenient short-term solution, you will never, it's very difficult to get a majority for the more ambitious medium-term solution. Therefore, that is the problem of moral hazard in Europe. That is why we have to stick on this very difficult discussion.
My name is Jochen Weber, and I immigrated to the United States from Germany 7 years ago, and I wanted to say thank you, Mr. Schäuble, for coming here tonight. My question is a little unrelated to what you were talking about, but I'm wondering to what extent you think that in Europe there is a stronger culture for security and safety, and I'm wondering if people are, young people are faced with the question, what I'm going to do with my life, and they study something, they try to get training, and then have the option to either go into, let's say, financial sector, banking, which at the moment it seems, well, it's not so much risk Whereas like in other occupations, particularly production, innovation, there seems to be much higher risk. If policy could help ameliorate that by really saying, well, income that comes from financial transactions, from banking, will be higher tax than we actually give a lower tax or kind of premium to people who try to innovate, to produce, who actually want to put their energy and life into something that is not just the, you know, like moving around money, but actually trying to create something. Thank you.
It's always difficult if you try as government to tell young people what they should choose for their career. Maybe you give, they are giving wrong or better incentives, but if you try to decide for them, it will not work. And therefore, and look, a system of taxation in which you are saying, if you are doing so, you have to pay more taxes. It's not the best system. Look, you have to, by the way, we the young generation in Europe is, I think the incoming generation is partly very, very good. And I am quite optimistic that they will be more flexible. They are more mobile. They are much more, you may remember we have to learn even in Germany, that to live with people from all over the world is a new experience. Therefore, if you look, we have partly in Europe remaining some rest of xenophobia. If you look where, it's only there where have been no foreigners. We have xenophobia, for example, in Germany, where in parts of Germany, which were the former GDR, where no foreigners you never could work with. Therefore, what you don't know, you can fear. And now this new generation is much more open, much more moderate, and integration works very well in huge parts of Europe, not only in Germany. But if we would tell the young generation to no, you have to decide yourself. That's the risk of freedom. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon. First of all, I'd like to thank SIPA and Minister and also professors for organizing this event. It's really been a privilege. My name is Isabella Grisanti. I'm a Venezuelan student from the Program in Economic Policy Management. Professor Svenner and Professor Calvo are two of my professors. My question is a little bit more policy-oriented. I'm wondering, given your extensive political experience, what has been the negotiation that has been most challenging for you to face until this point? What was the topic, and how did you overcome it?
Oh, maybe the most challenging issue for negotiation was German reunification. Mm. Yes, we have to deliver it the advantage was we had to do it in some weeks. We had no time, and that was a good pressure.
Thank you very much.
Let me welcome Katharina Pistor, who is a distinguished professor in the law school here and recipient of the Max Planck Award. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Herr Schäuble, thank you very much for coming here. I just have a very short question. What is the future of democracy in Europe, and how does it coalesce with European integration? We've talked about fiscal union, we've talked about European integration, and you have painted a rather positive picture of how to get there in step by step. But I think the one thing that's being sacrificed on the path towards economic and monetary integration might be democracy.
By sure. Yes. That is the very reason why we only move step by step in European integration. We can't go beyond. That is the very reason why we can only go step by step in European integration. We have to. We are representatives of the people. And if you don't, if you fail to convince people for what you want to achieve, you have to leave.
But who are the people in Europe today?
the people are the people in the nation states. But of course, there is some change. That is moving. I think the people in Europe are, look, most people in Europe are, for example, agree, if you look at polls, for a European army. No problem. No problem at all. You have majorities, even in France. In French polls, you have a clear majority for a European instead of a national army. It was not to be to imagined 30 years ago. It's a fact. The European integration is partly not, but of course it's a very sensitive mode, and that is, of course, if I link the first question of Madame Casella with your question, that is the key problem. Therefore, we have to link all this knowledge of economists with the expertise of political leaders, and then it remains complicated. But I think, even in this regard, we will move in a trial and error. And therefore, sometimes I like to make jokes. And though I have said, maybe you know, not for labor market research, but for European integration, you can get a European award, the so-called Charlemagne Prize, which is the most award for European integration. And I have said, maybe in some years we will award the Charlemagne Prize for European integration to Vladimir Putin, because he is telling the Europeans European integration matters.
Well, on that upbeat note, I suggest we thank Minister Schäuble for his excellent presentation and all the panelists for participating. And thank you all very much for coming.
Thank you.